Graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic audio presents Lou Prophet, Bounty Hunter. Book 11, Hell's Angel, by Peter Brandvold. Narrated by Bradley Foster Smith and performed by a full cast.
Dios mío!
The senorita's eyes flew wide.
Look, you must go. My husband is home, huh?
Husband? Benita, you're a whore.
Not anymore, Lou.
She stared up at the bounty hunter, chocolate eyes bright with terror. She squirmed beneath him, her full breasts raked warmly against his chest.
Lou, oh, you must go. He is an angry man, very jealous. If he sees us together, he will kill you.
Lou Prophet stopped bucking against the lovely senorita, Ramona Oscuro, whom he'd met a couple of years before here in the little border village of San Simon when he'd been on the run from the Federales.
Huh?
He stared down at her, incredulous. It was deep night, but downstairs in the hotel's little cantina, boots thudded.
Hola, my little chili pepper. Your husband is home.
Shit! That ain't Colonel Compa, is it? Commander of the local Rurale outpost?
See? He is a very jealous man, Lou. He married me to keep me pure. Though I have it on good word, he still tumbles with any girl he gets heated up for.
Oh, shit.
Prophet rolled off the bed, climbing to his feet and looking around on the scarred wooden floor for his underwear.
That son of a bitch was dogging me for 3 days through Chihuahua. Accused me of holding up a stage on the old Comanche Trail. Knows damn well that I didn't. That was Missouri Charlie Black, Poncho Scudder. Compa just soured on me after I cut his ear off in a fair knife fight in Juarez 2 years ago last Christmas.
That was you?
Didn't mean to. Meant to cut his throat. But I was too drunk to see straight. He said if he ever saw me in Mexico again, he'd see me shot down in front of the nearest adobe wall.
Prophet stepped into his ball brigands, drew them up his legs, having to squat and wriggle around to get the skin-tight, threadbare garment up his thick, brawny 6'4" frame without ripping out the seams.
Oh, lost him 2 days ago. Didn't figure on him thinking to look for me here, in the same little village he's headquartered in.
I have brought you a present, my little mountain flower.
Prophet glanced at Ramona skeptically as he scooped his denim trousers off a chair back.
Mountain flower. He's quite a poet, the bastardo. I only married him because I was tired of going from man to man, and I was drunk. I'm not as young as I used to be. I'll be 20 next month. Oh, the years catch up to us all. Hurry, Lou. He's in the hall.
Prophet clamped his pants under his arm, then stooped to grab his boots into which he'd stuffed his socks when he and Ramona had come up to her room after the fandango in the village plaza to get down to the business of the flesh.
Oh, shit.
Prophet clamped his boots under his arm with his pants. He slung his cartridge belt and holstered peacemaker over his shoulder, retrieved his sawed-off 10-gauge double-barrel coach gun from where he'd hung it by its leather lanyard from a wall spike, and picked up his Winchester 73 repeater that he'd leaned against the wall by the door. As well-armed as he himself was, he could blow Compa into bits the size of a cow's cud. But if he ambushed him here in his own town, he'd have every Rurale in northern Chihuahua after him, and he'd never again be able to hunt bounties south of the border. Mexico was the primest of hunting grounds. Whenever the outlaw herds were holed up tighter than ticks in a cur's ear up north, Prophet knew he could fund at least another year of stomping with his tail up by turning his sights on the other side of the Rio Bravo.
Ramona! It is I, your stallion, ready to impale you of my manhood!
Christ, Ramona, couldn't you have done a little better than that?
I told you I was drunk. That scar where you cut off his ear did nothing for his looks either.
Hey, you married him.
Who are you talking to, Chiquita?
Ramona clamped her hands over her mouth, brown eyes appearing about to pop out of their sockets. Prophet had just opened the wooden shutters over the window. Now he swung around and cast an anxious glance at the door.
Oh, shit. You gonna be all right, Ramona girl? I'd hate like hell for...
Lou, who, my darling Ramona? You don't have a big, ugly bounty hunter by the name of Lou Prophet in there, do you? The one whose trail I was fogging across half the Chihuahua Desert!
Lou? Lou who, mi amor? You know I have eyes for no one but you.
Ramona kept waving frantically at Prophet, who looked out the window and into the straw-strewn yard at the back of the hotel. It was about 30 feet above the ground, but there was a rear gallery roof of woven ironwood branches roughly 15 feet below him and slightly to his right. Possibly he could land on that and then leap the rest of the way to the ground without killing himself.
Possibly.
Kampa was rattling the door latch.
Open the door, Chiquita. Ah! Open the door right now, or I will blow it open!
Coming, my bull!
Ramona shot Prophet another tense, frantic glance as she bounded up out of the bed and uncoiled her cool, naked body, starting for the door.
Just one second, my wild stud horse.
The rickety door flew open. Prophet was crouched atop the windowsill now, but as the burly, shaggy-headed Kampa bounded into the room with his two pearl-gripped pistols drawn, the bounty hunter threw himself, his load of clothes, and a small arsenal off the casement, angling toward the brush roof below. The woven branches broke apart as his feet hit them, and suddenly the big man was falling on through the roof to pile up in a heap on the gallery floor below. Prophet had dropped his gear and lay writhing, bells tolling in his ears, pale doves flapping before his eyes, his feet and ankles burning.
Young kid, son of a bitch!
Prophet looked through the ragged hole he'd made in the roof above to see, slightly to one side, the Rurale's round, dark face shrouded by his shaggy hair, glaring down at him, white teeth showing between lips sheathed in long, drooping mustaches.
Die, you bastard!
Prophet rolled to one side and began quickly gathering his gear.
Die, you son of a bitch!
A slug sliced a burn across Prophet's right shoulder.
No! No, Arturo, no! He means nothing to me!
Thanks a bunch, Ramona.
Prophet bolted out from under the gallery roof, heading for the cover of brush and stock pens beyond the saloon. The livery barn in which he'd stabled his horse lay in that direction, north, though a good 70 or so yards away. He hoped like hell he'd be able to find it on so dark a moonless night. The bullets blew up dust, straw, and chicken shit around Prophet's hammering heels. Crouching, knees pumping, clutching his gear to his body, his shell belt and holstered 45 flapping against his right side, he traced a serpentine path to make himself as hard a target as possible for the drunken Rurale colonel. Prophet kept running until he was sure he was out of range of Kampa's pistols. Shouldering up to the rear corner of a small, dark casa, he dropped his gear on the ground, then picked through until he'd found his socks. Looking around cautiously, he pulled the socks on and then reached for his pants.
Swing a la larva!
Oh, hell. Who ever heard of a whore getting married? Especially one as talented as Senorita Ramona.
Prophet picked up his pants, quickly stepped into them, and then into his boots. when he pulled on his buckskin shirt and thumbed his suspenders up over his broad shoulders. He wrapped his shell belt around his waist, buckled it, and tied the thong securing the holster housing his walnut-gripped .45 Peacemaker low on his right thigh. He looped his shotgun over his shoulder, picked up his rifle, and set off running through the brush and scattered casas and stock pens in the general direction he remembered the livery barn to be.
Ahí está!
He whipped a look to his left. Two men in dove gray uniforms and straw sombreros were running towards him.
Dinner!
One of them brought his trapdoor Springfield rifle to bear. Prophet extended his double-barreled coach gun in his left hand. He triggered the left barrel. The nearest Rurale flew 2 feet up and straight back, his sombrero tumbling down his chest. The other Rurale jerked his rifle stock to his shoulder. A fist-sized wad of buckshot tore through the man.
Sorry, amigos, but better you than me.
Prophet swung away from the dead Rurales and continued running for his horse, hearing more shouts rising beneath the concerned tolling of that damned bell. Prophet approached the livery barn that sat near the north edge of San Simon, near the old crumbling adobe church that humped up beyond it, blotting out the stars. He'd chosen the barn because it was off the beaten path, and he figured no Rurales would house their own horses there and recognize his own rather conspicuous, somewhat notorious beast, the appropriately named Mean and Ugly. Now he slipped between the wooden doors and drew them closed behind him. There were only 4 or 5 stalls in the place, with a paddock out in back. As he latched the doors and quickly lifted the bale on a lantern to light it, a voice spoke in Spanish from the dense shadows.
If you're here to rob me, I must inform you that I am old and blind, and the merciful Jesus watches over me and my horses from the cathedral next door. Stealing pesos from me will get you sent straight to hell.
Prophet hung the lantern on a rusty nail.
Go back to bed, old man. It's only me, Lou Prophet. I'm just gonna saddle my horse and fog the sage. I'd appreciate it if you'd never heard of me, if anyone asks. Especially the men of Arturo Campa.
Oh, you.
The old man, whose name Prophet remembered was Santiago something or other, materialized like a lumpy ghost in the murky shadows, carrying his own spy-flecked candle by its handle.
The bell tolls for thee?
It tolls for all of us, sooner or later.
Prophet stepped into his horse's stall, a mean, hammer-headed roan twitching his ears devilishly.
I should have known it was you.
What do I owe you?
Prophet threw his saddle blanket over Mean's back.
6 pesos. And an extra one for the patience required to house and feed such a wretched, contrary beast. He tore the seam in my sarape earlier, when I was only trying to comb him.
I'll make it 7.
Go back to bed, Santiago. My feet are cold.
The old man gave a wan smile and shrugged.
Leave it on the water barrel.
He and his lantern slipped back into the shadows, and Prophet quickly rigged up the dun in the darkness. Mean stomped and snorted, playful and excited despite the lateness of the hour to hit the trail again. Mean and Ugly didn't care to be housed in livery barns unless there was a frisky mare or two for him to touch noses with, stomp with, and to generally try to impress despite the fact that he'd lost his balls to the gelding knife many years before. Prophet had just turned his back on the horse to grab his saddlebags, when out of the corner of his eye he saw the dun lower his long snout toward the bounty hunter's shoulder and peel his leathery lips away from his teeth.
God damn your cursed hide!
Prophet jerked around and smashed his left elbow against the side of the horse's stout jaw just in time to keep the shoulder of his tunic from being ripped out. The horse lurched back, blowing, snorting, shaking its head, twitching its ears, and showing his teeth. If there were ever a horse who could laugh in ribald mockery at its rider, that horse was mean and ugly.
Why the hell did you do that?
Prophet tossed his saddlebags over the wicked beast's back behind his saddle.
As if I got all night to dance around in here with you, sporting for a fight. We got them rurales on our asses again. No thanks to Senorita Ramona. If you can't trust a whore, who can you trust? And I got no damn time for your nonsense. You know, if I had a lick of sense, I would have listened to everyone who's so willingly given their opinion on the subject and ridden you off to the damn glue factory years ago.
He led the horse to the front of the barn, blew out the lantern, tossed some coins onto the rain barrel's wooden cover, and then slipped out between the doors, closing them quietly behind him. He cocked his head to listen. The bells had stopped tolling. The silence was even more menacing than the tolling had been. Kampa's rurales were after him, but where were they searching?
Oh, well, at least they don't know where I am either.
He stepped into the leather and slid his shotgun over his shoulder, letting it dangle down his back, and booted the horse around the side of the livery barn, wanting to light a shuck out of San Simon as quickly as possible, but also get as far away as he could from the rurale outpost on the south edge of town. He followed an angling horse trail northwest into the hills toward the Rio Bravo that cut through the desert along the southern edge of the Boot Heel of Texas, too damn many miles beyond. He did not gallop the mount and risk mean breaking a leg and stranding him out here at the mercy of Kampa, but only trotted up and down the long hills cloaked in starlight. Several times he stopped to let the horse rest and drink from his hat. He'd left San Simon so quickly that he hadn't had time to fill his canteen, so he continued north across the dry Chihuahuan desert with only a little brackish water sloshing around in the flask. There was a Mexican stage line that ran through this part of the desert, and there were of course wells at all of the stations along the line, but since he didn't know their exact locations, finding one in the dark would be almost impossible. Best to avoid the stations for as long as he could. As few folks who saw him on his run to the border, the better. He'd stay clear of the country's main trails as well. If he was lucky, he'd run into a spring. If not, he and Mean would have to wait to refresh themselves at the Rio Bravo. They'd gone without water before. He continued riding, slowly but steadily widening the distance between himself and Kampa. Staying off the main trail should buy him enough time to get across the border before the jealous rurale colonel could catch up to him. It would be damn near impossible for Kampa's men to track him out here in the dark. There was no moon, and it didn't look like there was gonna be one, and while the stars were bright, they weren't bright enough for efficient tracking. After an hour of relatively hard riding, hearing no one behind him, Prophet allowed himself a saddle snooze. When he awoke, he rested Mean, dampened the horse's mouth and nostrils with a wet bandana, and then set off once more. Dawn found him skirting a broad canyon that he knew fed into the canyon of the Rio Grande, which meant he was getting close to the border. The gray light turned a soft red, and shadows drifted out from rocks and small bunches of dry brown grass. The sky turned slowly from green to a cobalt blue. To each side were mountains. Behind were the rolling brown, rock-stippled hills he'd passed through in the dark. Around 9 o'clock, judging by the sun's angle, he spied some relatively heavy growth sheathing an arroyo just east of him. He had reined Mean and Ugly into the shallow wash when he saw shiny water bubbling up from tan shale rock along the wash's southern bank. The water winked gold in the intense desert sunlight. A kangaroo rat scurried behind a hump of gray rock on his left, and he could hear the grunts of what was likely a javelina that had probably been enjoying the water before Prophet and Mean had interrupted it. Mean smelled the water and shook his head in eager anticipation, rattling the bit in his teeth. Prophet rode the horse ahead and climbed heavily out of the saddle, looking around carefully.
When water's this scarce,
There's likely to be more critters nearby than wild pigs and kangaroo rats. Border toughs, maybe. Possibly Kiowa.
When he'd slipped the bit from Mean's mouth and loosened his latigo strap so that the hammer-headed dun could drink freely, Prophet dropped the reins and let the horse have at the chuckling spring. While the horse drank, Prophet climbed the arroyo's north bank, starting a little bit at a sand rattler that had been sunning itself on a flat rock, but now slithered quickly off into the rocks. Mean continued to drink, twitching his tail at flies as Prophet scanned the area for interlopers. When he figured Mean had had enough, he went down and pulled the horse back away from the spring and crouched beside it, doffing his hat and lowering his mouth to catch a slender freshet tumbling over the shelving sandstone. The water wasn't overcool, but it was fresh. It tasted richly of minerals. Instantly, he felt it reviving him. When he'd had a bellyful, he walked over to where Mean stood hip-cocked and unslung his canteen from his saddle horn. The canteen jerked wildly in Prophet's hand.
Shit!
Prophet dropped the ruined flask and lunged for his rifle. At the same time, but 50 miles north of the Rio Grande, the dwarf, Mordecai Moon, sat back in his child-sized wicker rocking chair on the porch of his big, gaudy saloon called Moon's House of a Thousand Delights and stared out at the broad, dusty street of the town that was formerly known as Chisos Springs, but which Moon himself had renamed in his own honor, Moon's Well. Moon had renamed the town when he'd purchased the saloon from the old trader and prospector Chisos LaGrange. LaGrange had been a half-mad prospector who'd haunted the Chisos Mountains to the west for nearly 30 years. Around his precious well, which offered the only steady supply of water in 100 square miles, a small town had gradually grown after LaGrange himself had built a saloon 50 feet from the well. Suffering from multiple afflictions in his later years, LaGrange later sold the land grant as well as the well and the saloon to Mordecai Moon. Moon raised the saloon and built another far grander affair than LaGrange's humble little watering hole and named it with the dwarf's own personal flair and unabashed aplomb. Now, LaGrange's diminutive successor, Mordecai Moon, sitting on Moon's House of a Thousand Delights' broad front gallery, poked his black bowler hat off his round head and hauled a folding Barlow knife from a side pocket of his black claw hammer coat. He ran the razor-edged blade along the edge of his left thumbnail and pooched out his thin, chapped lips in concentration. With his beak-like, bulb-tipped, bright red nose, his deep-set, cobalt-blue eyes ringed with sickly yellow whites, and a knobby chin fringed with colorless goat whiskers, Moon was considered by most to be the ugliest specimen, man or beast, to be found within all of West Texas. No one ever said this to Moon's face, however. At least they didn't and lived to laugh about it. Moon shaved off a narrow bit of the grime-encrusted nail, letting the shaving drop to the floor of the broad wooden veranda painted lime green, then closed the knife and shoved it back down into the pocket of his frock coat, which he'd had specially made to fit his diminutive frame. Mordecai Moon sat back in his chair, which he'd pulled up close enough to the gallery's front edge that he could extend his stubby, bowed, 2-foot-long legs and hike his little boy's black boots atop the rail and cross them, which is what he did. Moon was fixing to take a mid-morning nap so he'd be well-rested for the night's business when he spied movement on the sun-blasted, rock- and cacti-tufted desert to the north, just beyond the town. Two riders were following the old Chihuahua trail, which was the only trail through Moon's Well, and which became the town's broad main drag and remained so for 100 yards before it slithered off into the desert once more. A flowery, pale line twisting and turning and rising and falling through one watery mirage after another, all the way to the Rio Grande and beyond. Boots clomped behind Moon, issuing from inside the saloon, the two broad front doors of which had been propped open with rocks. In the corner of his right eye, Moon spied movement, and he raked his eyes from the two oncoming riders to see his girl, Griselda May, leaning against the door frame, her long, dark brown hair dancing in the hot, dry breeze.
Anything happening out here yet, Mordecai? I'm bored.
Mordecai smiled, his little dark blue eyes turning shiny and round, his thick lips stretching back from his large, tobacco-crusted teeth.
Oh, you just hold on, Griselda. Things will be hopping soon. George Montgomery's bull train is due through here in a couple hours, and then we'll wake the band.
Is this Friday, Mordecai?
It is that, Griselda. It's Friday.
Oh, shucks. Now I'm really bored. Bored and anxious. Oh, I'm so hot. I'm so tired of the sun, Mordecai. I want it to be night.
Griselda sauntered over, swinging her hips inside her skin-tight black denims behind brush-scarred, red-stitched black leather leggings and cuffed Moon's hat off his forehead. She planted a wet kiss on his freckled cheek.
What do you say we go upstairs and tussle till dark?
Oh, no, you get. Don't you go get me worked up again, Griselda. I ain't as young as you. I'm liable to turn into old Frank Rose over yonder.
Moon glanced at the saloon sitting a ways west and on the other side of the street from Moon's place. The Rose Hotel and Saloon was far less grand than Moon's place. It was an old mud brick affair with two stories and a brush roof. Originally, the Mexican tenants had built it with Chisos LaGrange's blessing. He'd had more business than he knew what to do with, and then abandoned it for unknown reasons. The saloon was now owned by Frank and Ruth Rose, who'd bought it from Moon. They were now his tenants, as was everyone else in the town of Moon's Well, though their dream of prospering here in Moon's Well along the old Chihuahua Trail had withered the day, nearly a year ago, Frank Rose was cut down and bedridden by a brain stroke.
Well, please now, Griselda. I'm going to end up like Frank Rose, and you'll be feeding me mush with a spoon. You keep working my tired old bones like you've been.
Sure couldn't tell that by this morning.
Griselda stuck the tip of her tongue in Moon's ear.
You performed right well, Mr. Mordecai Moon.
No, now you stop or you're going to get the old snake stirring in its hole.
I want it to stir. I like your snake, Mordecai.
Oh, looky there. We got someone coming.
Moon pointed toward the riders just now swimming up out of the brassy mirage and entering the outskirts of Moon's Well. Long, tan dusters flapped out around them as their horses loped past the town's original mud shacks and stock pens and corrals constructed of brush and ocotillo stalks. They both wore Stetsons and string ties, and pistols were tied down on their thighs. Badges of some sort flashed silver whenever their flapping dusters exposed the lapels of their wool vests to the sun. The lawmen came on toward the saloon. Moon sat up straight in his chair, boots still crossed on the porch rail before him. Griselda kept her hand on his left shoulder, and he held his hand over hers, vacantly returning the affection, though Moon's interest was mainly on the newcomers now.
Want me to wake Kench and Steele?
Nah. Hell, let them sleep. They're gonna need to be in top form when the bull teams pull in, watching the gambling tables and making sure the girls get paid.
Drawing up to the well that sat directly in front of Moon's saloon, the lawmen swung heavily down from their saddles. taller man was looking at one of the two signs mounted on posts abutting the well on which Moon had written the cost for water.
Dick, look at this.
The other one slapped his hat against his leg, causing dust to puff thickly around him, and hitched his big Colt pistol high on his right hip. He came around to stare up at the sign.
What in the hell? Chisos never charged for water.
And I'll be goddamned if I pay for it.
They both shook their heads while the taller lawman took the bucket off the hook. The taller lawman turned the handle on the winch as the bucket dropped down into the dank, humid depths of the well. Mordecai Moon smiled at them from his perch on the porch.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.